Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome once again to another Monday night here at the Scattered Brethren Network. And it's crazy tonight because it's a good thing I already know what I look like because I can't see myself at all. I've got a little phone sitting next to me. So I guess that's going to work for me tonight. And as long as you can see me and hear me, and if you can't, please let me know. Greetings, Tom and Tilly. And let's see, who else? Coco, thanks for being here. And Carlos and Mark and James, thanks for being here. And Brenda, from here from the Olympia, Washington congregation. And who else do we have here tonight with us? Did I say Mark? Yep, and we've got Sharon Brown is with us tonight. Thank you, Sharon. If I've missed somebody, Nancy, you're here tonight with us. That's great. And everybody else that I'm missing, I'm scanning real quick here to see who's here. And it's a pleasure to have you all with me. If there's anything crazy going on the audio or the video, please let me know. I'll try to look up every once in a while and see what you might be telling me. It is so good to have you here. You know, the primary reason for the Scattered Brethren Network is to connect people like you and me together for fellowship, either online or hopefully even, you know, in your own neck of the woods where you can meet with people in person and have fellowship that way as well. When I started this thing back around 2006 with great help and in partnership with the Restoration Fellowship, Anthony Buzzard, Carlos Xavier, when he came on board in 2010, and just that whole group out there, it was a real pleasure. And we started gathering people together and finding them. And I started the thing primarily for selfish reasons, because I live over here on the West Coast, and there was only like five groups or congregations that I had been established that I knew about west of the Missouri River, and one closed down, and then we set up ours in 2013. So there's still only five that I'm aware of counting us. So, you know, it was kind of slim pickings out here, and I don't like being alone. I like fellowship with people who think as I do on a spiritual level. And so I kept looking. I called it Northwest Scattered Brethren Network, and then people from outside the North Pacific Northwest said, hey, what about us? I mean, we're looking for fellowship too, and we love it if you'd extend yourself out from there. And then people from Europe started getting in touch with me and saying, hey, us too, we're looking. So it turns out we're all looking. So you know, we continue that. We've got over 1530 connections so far. We continue our partnership with some of the good churches in the Church of God General Conference. And of course, first and foremost, with the Restoration Fellowship. And since that time, I've established many great friendships with those in our family of faith. So it's just so good to have you all here. And you know, from the past, I've told you lots about ministries. Go back and check some of my other videos tonight. I probably won't spend time talking about those connections, because many of them you know about. The focusonthekingdom.org and the koemissions.com, Tracy Z, and of course, Bible studies through Lori Jane, which you can get to her, I know, through Tracy Z at koemissions.com. So if there are any ex-Jehovah Witnesses out there, please get a hold of Lori Jane. Go through kogmissions.com and connect with Lori. I'm sure there are other ways to connect with her. I just don't have them in front of me right now. You can also get with Dennis Baldwin. He's got Saturday evening, I believe. Check my last video. It tells you there how to get a hold of Dennis Baldwin on the East Coast. He's got a weekly Bible studies on Zoom. He's got an email address. I think it's tonybald1@aol.com. I'm not sure. Again, go back to my video from last week. In fact, here it is right here. tonybald1@yahoo.com. My apologies. Then you've got another one with Ray Faircloth in the UK. You can email him at rcfaircloth at msn.com for his Saturday afternoon, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time Bible studies. So there's lots of opportunities out there. Our main purpose here is to connect you all together for fellowship. And like I say, we got over 1,530 people now. I've lost track. And that's our primary purpose. That is our only purpose, in fact. And the reason I've got the live stream going here is because I want to give you face-to-face, you know, encouragement that the Scattered Brethren Network, you know, does have a face behind it and has actual people supporting it, like those who are here at the Western Washington Church of God. Support the ministry here so we can keep coming out to you week after week, most weeks. And hi, Tracy. Thanks for being here tonight. The one thing I will mention more before I move on, well, two things. One is our website, if you don't know, is www.scatteredbrethren.org. And click on the regions tab, find your neck of the woods. And then if you find a city or town near you, that means it's got at least one believer in it. And I'll see if I can't send me a message, and I'll see if I can't hook you up with them. The other thing I want to tell you about is that April 5th will be the yearly online theological conference that the Restoration Fellowship is putting on. And it starts on Tuesday, April 5th, 7 p.m. at night, Eastern Standard Time. There'll be a couple of us giving presentations. And then on Saturday, you got five or six presentations from some good speakers there, including Anthony Buzzard. And it concludes on Sunday at 10 or 10:30, I'm not sure which, with a sermon by Dennis Baldwin, good friend of ours, pastor out there on the East Coast. So if you want more information and to stay connected with the things happening with that conference coming right up in a week or so, a couple weeks now, just go to theologicalconference.org. That's theological. I'm going to let you spell it. Theologicalconference.org, and check it out and get all the information. Okay, I want to talk to you tonight. Thanks for letting me give you my gospel thoughts, I call them, for the week. Things I've been thinking about this week. I call it ruling the nations with a rod of iron. And I want to begin my thoughts with you tonight with a little talk about King David. Now, you remember that King David was anointed as a young man, a young boy, still at home with his brothers and his father, Jesse. And God said, Samuel, I want you to go anoint, you know, David. Well, he didn't know it was David yet, but he found out pretty quick. So he went there and he anointed this young boy, David, and he anointed him king. He became king, and yet he had all the authority of a king because he was anointed as king, but he didn't exercise his authority. He was not able. It was not time for him to exercise his authority yet because, even though he was king, because Saul was still sitting on the throne. And yet, you know, many years passed, and he gathered followers who were respectful of him as the king of Israel. And even though he didn't exercise his authority, they looked to him as king. They were followers of King David. They were like, you know, King David was sort of like gathering his future administration. He'd be all set and ready to go when the time came, whenever that was, for him to start exercising the authority of his anointing. And, you know, Jesus is just like his father David in that respect, his ancestor David, whose throne he is to sit on. Because Jesus has been anointed. He is the king. He has all the authority of the king. And I don't know what he does out there, but like in the universe, he's king and he may be exercising that authority, but he has not yet begun to exercise kingship authority over the nations of the earth, as it is expressed biblically. That's not happened yet. And yet he has followers. He has those who follow him around wherever he goes, just like King David had his followers. And we follow him around and we give our minds and our hearts to over to his authority. So when he comes, you know, we're heirs of the kingdom, but not yet inheritors. We're acting as if we are in the kingdom, even though the kingdom is not here yet, in the way that the Bible speaks about it. And that's the only way we can think about it. It's the only right way and proper way to think about the kingdom of God. So we may know a lot about the kingdom. We may be able, we've got the seed of the kingdom. We've got the word of the kingdom. We act as if we're in the kingdom. We're given, you know, certain power through the Holy Spirit in us to live according to those principles. And yet the kingdom is not actually here yet because Jesus is not exercising his authority in that kingdom from the throne of David yet in Jerusalem. So I want to go over a few scriptures with you tonight. It's very important that we understand how the Bible talks about the kingdom of God. Very important that we don't go beyond what is written, what the Bible has given to us. And that we don't take away from it either, as it says in the book of Revelation. Don't take away the words of the book about the kingdom of God, which Jesus preached. So let's just go over a few scriptures, these obvious ones. I know you've probably been over them 100 times, but if we don't keep doing that from time to time, you're going to lose what you have. You're going to forget, because we want to cling to those obvious things that God has told us. And they're there for a reason. Believe me, if you start messing around with the truth even a little bit, and you go a little off course, it's going to take you down paths that you're not meant to go, and you're going to make more and more doctrinal errors as you go from there. So let's start with Daniel 7:27, right? So this is the prophet Daniel, who has seen a vision of the coming kingdom of God, same as he did in Daniel in Daniel 2:44, when he saw this big statue, which is all the governments of the earth, you know, finally at the end of the age crashing, a big stone not made with human hands comes out from heaven and hits it on its toes, and the whole thing crumbles. And in Daniel 7:27, says this about that: then the sovereignty, the dominion, and the greatness of all the kingdoms under the whole heaven will be given to the people of the saints of the highest one. And his kingdom will be an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions will serve and obey him. Okay, all right, it's a literal kingdom on the earth. We get it. How about Revelation 3:21? Jesus says, he who overcomes, notice the timing of this. Once you overcome, I will grant to him to sit down with me on my throne as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. Well, he who endures to the end, the same shall be saved. He who overcomes wins that. The end of your life, man. You're living and enduring to the end of your life so that you can be considered worthy and Jesus raises you from the dead to be with him in his kingdom reign when he begins that. So far, pretty elementary. He who overcomes, I'll grant to sit down with me on my throne. The sovereignty of the whole kingdom. Revelation 20, verse 6 supports this. Blessed and holy is the one who has a part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Okay, this is confirmation of everything that we've read so far. But so far, we don't have any other details. It's exciting to consider, of course. It's truth, but it's a little bit benign yet. We don't really have description of what Christ and the saints' rule looks like. You know, what does it entail? Kind of what's at the heart and core of it? And to get to that, and this is really important, I want to start with Psalm chapter 2, verses 7 to 12. I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will surely give you the nations as your inheritance and the very ends of the earth as your possession." And look at this. This is what I'm talking about. "You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall shatter them like earthenware. Now, therefore, O kings, watch out. Show discernment. Take warning, O judges of the earth. Worship the Lord with reverence and rejoice with trembling. Do homage to the Son, that he not become angry and you perish in the way, for his wrath may soon be kindled. But how blessed are all who take refuge in him." If you take refuge in him, if you do homage to the Son, everything is going to be great. But, you know, if you don't show discernment, if you don't give yourself over to the returning King of Kings and Lord of Lords, when he comes to reign over the earth, he's going to reign with a rod of iron. He has that right. He has that opportunity to go that route, and he will have to do that in some cases, because not everybody is going to accept his reign. For one thing, think about all the times over the course of thousands of years we've been disappointed by the governments of this world who have not had our best interests in mind, but have wanted to oppress the people that they govern. So when Jesus comes and establishes his kingdom on the earth, people are likely to be, you know, a little bit shell-shocked. You know, it's like, how can we trust you? Well, they'll learn. But unfortunately, at the end of the age, we find in the book of Revelation in chapter 9, at the end of the chapter, even after all the chaos and confusion at the end of the age, people still, it says, will not repent. So when things get bad enough and the evil becomes so oppressive that people get trapped in it and can't get out and don't even see why they're there, they don't repent, and there's no way out of, you know, the oppression of the evil governments over man, Jesus is going to, at some point then, he's going to come back, and he's the one who's going to have to rescue us by establishing his kingdom and by reigning with a rod of iron. He's going to have to put down the rebellions. He's going to have to forcibly put down the evil that exists at the time. Revelation 2, 26 to 27 brings you and hopefully me into this picture too. Jesus said, "He who overcomes and who keeps my deeds until the end, to him I will give authority over the nations." And how? What kind of authority over the nations? "And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of potter are broken to pieces, as I also have received authority from my Father." Look, this is not a kingdom in the heart of a man or a woman. This is not what I call a wet noodle, you know, reign. This is a rod of iron reign. I mean, if Jesus is reigning over the nations right now, if he's exercising that reign, that authority, then it's not with a rod of iron. I'd have to say he's using a wet noodle, but he doesn't do that. That's not how he's doing things. That's not how he's going to do things. He's got more authority than that, and he's going to exercise more than that. And the Bible calls it a rod of iron that can smash and crush and destroy and scatter the pieces of pottery. That's how it's going to have to be sometimes, at least at first. Look at what it says in Revelation 19, verse 11 to 16. "And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems, and he has a name written on him, which no one knows except himself. He is clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word. The Word of God. And the armies which are in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword, so that with it he may strike down the nations. And he will rule them with a rod of iron. Not a wet noodle, okay? I hope you're not offended by that metaphor, but I mean, I don't know how to make this more plain. What kind of rulership we're talking about and have not seen to date from Jesus. And he treads the winepress of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty, and on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Even when Jesus returns, it's recorded in the book of Zechariah in chapter 14. It says, then it will come about that any who are left of the nations that went against Jerusalem in that chaotic time at the end will go up from year to year, those people will, to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to celebrate the Feast of Booths. And it will be that whichever families of the earth does not go up to Jerusalem to worship the King, to worship King Jesus, the Lord of hosts, there will be no rain on them. Now that's impactful. That's what I call impactful rulership, reigning. So if you don't see that, the kingdom of God is not here. I suggest to you that it is not. The kingdom of God principles, we know. We know the coming king of that kingdom. We know where he's going to sit. We know that swords are going to be turned into plowshares and spears into pruning hooks when he rules over the nations with a rod of iron with his saints. But right now, that's not happening, and it hasn't happened up to this point. So we can talk all we want to, and we're perfectly legit to talk about the kingdom of God as having principles that we live by right now. And we are heirs of the kingdom. We are ambassadors for that future government and way of life that's coming. People want to see the kingdom of God in you and in your life. But that doesn't mean the kingdom of God is here. The fact of the matter is, it is not. And there are complications that arise if we allow ourselves to go down a road and expand our definition of what that kingdom is. And I don't have time to go into that tonight, but there are things first of all, we really don't understand God if we don't understand that a time is coming. Apparently it's 1,000 years according to Jesus. But there's a time coming when Jesus and the saints are going to rule over unbelieving nations with a rod of iron if necessary. And, you know, Egypt and Assyria are two examples of nations who are now opposed to God, who are going to come and worship God. The same as the Creator, the Yahweh, the God of Israel, they're going to worship. Isaiah chapter 19, you can check it out. That's going to happen. So there is that time period. So we don't want to deny this part of God's nature to forgive and to heal and to save those who are not yet saved in the nations, the masses of people in the first phase of the coming kingdom of God. Let's not condemn those people. Let's not condemn other people like them. It's not our job, number one, and it's just plain wrong to think of people that way, because that's not how God thinks of them. And not only that, but when you there are some ways of thinking where the kingdom of God now kind of theology, that is, the kingdom of God exists now as well as later, that leads to other errors. Like, for example, there's not two resurrections divided by a literal millennium. There's only one resurrection. That's literal. And that one resurrection includes people now who've come to the truth and accepted it, but doesn't include anybody else. Everyone else then is cut off at that moment of Christ's return. No hope. That is just not the lesson of the millennium, the literal millennium that the Bible gives us through the prophets and even beyond that, even beyond the millennium, what's to come of those billions and billions of people? Certainly everybody deserves death. So do you. So do I. But God gave us something. He opened our eyes to things. Not all things, because nobody knows everything yet, do they? You don't know everything. I don't know everything. But we know enough. And we believe enough of what God's asked us to believe that if we keep living according to it, he can trust us in the first phase of his kingdom. The first wave of those who will come to a right understanding and worship of God in the ages and ages to come. So that's all I really wanted to say tonight, and I know it's a lot. I've run out of time. I see you've got some side conversations going on, and that's just great. I want you guys to be able to fellowship with each other at least once a week here, and that's what I'm here for. That's why I come online, and I want to thank you for being here with me tonight and listening to those words. Go to scatteredbrethren.org if you from time to time at least, and see if there's any additional cities or towns that are near you. And if you haven't contacted me, you have to get in touch with those folks. Please do so. And so thanks all for being here. What else can I say? Jesus is coming. He's going to raise the faithful from the dead. And they're going to rule and reign with him on the earth with the rod of iron and in love, ultimately, for all the people. The very first government we'll have that really truly is for the people and for the human flourishing that God has always wanted. So thank you for joining me. We'll see you next time, God willing, next Monday night at same time, same place. Take care of yourselves. God bless. Bye for now.